Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of Real Talks. I'm your host, Brady Carducci, and today on the show, we have a very special guest. I mean, you can probably see already who it is. He's up on the screen now, but he is an up-and-coming creative designer, graphic designer, creative from Toronto. He's worked with some big names such as LB Spiffy, Houdini, Roy Woods, Six Buzz, some pretty big hitters. So please welcome to the show, Certified Benji. How's it going, man?
Hi, thanks for having me.
No problem, buddy. Thanks for taking some time out of your schedule to come talk with us today. I really appreciate it. I'm really excited to sit down with you, talk about, the success you've had so far in your career, just learn a little bit more about you and your craft. So before we get into it, I have to ask, COVID-19 has kind of put a little bit of a wrench in everyone's day-to-day. How have you been dealing with it and kind of keeping your sanity, I guess?
Thanks. To begin with, the COVID-19 whole situation was pretty weird because before COVID, I was like living a pretty like fast-paced life and doing many different things in my life. Mm-hmm. So like when it came to the time where I had to like go and I had so much time on my hands, it was sort of weird for me. But now like being in it for like more than a month or 2 months, I think now, mm-hmm. like I'm finding my own routine and stuff that I like. Like usually I start my day like exercising because like I find that starting my day like with something mentally tough, it just makes mm-hmm. everything else very easy. So I've been doing that. I've been brainstorming many new ideas, just designing, watching movies. I still have online class, so
I've How has that been going, like online class and stuff?
It's been going well. Like the first few weeks, like the teachers were new to it, but now a mm-hmm. lot of them are just posting the work and like it feels like school again, just at home.
Yeah, I have my littlest brother. I have two brothers, but he's in high school too, and so like he was telling me about like how the teachers are like transitioning online, and I just asked him like how it was. He's like, it's not too hard, but it's just like it was just like a big change, right, from being in a classroom. So a big adjustment.
I felt like I was spending more time on work now than before because throughout the week they would give us like time in class to work on it. I find myself like doing more work at home because it's basically like you're doing the homework and the classwork,
That's so. True. That's true. You can't do like the classwork in class and then take the homework home. You kind of do both. Awesome. So, you mentioned right now you're a student, but you're also a graphic designer. So you kind of, you balance both. What really sparked your interest in, graphic design? Like why did you want to get into it in the first place?
To start off, I was always into art, so I was always like doodling in my free time, and even in like elementary school when I started, I was doing like different art projects in school, so like I always had this love for art. Mm-hmm. My first interaction with graphic design was actually with my dad's friend from church, because he was doing graphic design for a church, and I really admired his work and really seen like him do stuff behind the scenes, because we're spending a lot of time at church, and I just see him do different stuff that like amazed me, so I went home and learned how to do it myself. And
I guess the rest is history from there.
Yeah, for
sure. That's cool. Did you, now when you were kind of like I guess learning and stuff, would you go to him and stuff if you had any questions, or would you kind of just like go to different resources?
First I really went to him and just seen like the programs that he used and like seen his workflow, but I never really told him that like I was gonna try it out, or like I just showed him that I had like an interest in it, but I didn't really put myself out there like, yo, this is something I want to try out, like, so I really felt like I wanted to do it on my own so I could sort of see how like things come out, so it wouldn't be like him pressuring me. It was something that I really want to do,
Yeah, no, that's good. Yeah, like you kind of like took initiative and was just like, okay, I'm going to do it myself and just see where it goes. I like that. So like for like programs and stuff, because I know, like, do you use like Adobe, the like Creative Suite to do all your designs?
Okay. I use the Adobe Creative Suite and then other things. Like I recently got an iPad, so I use Procreate.
Do you have the new one? Like the new one?
Yeah, I have the iPad Pro. I can show it to you.
How do you like it?
I like it really well because with my workflow, mm-hmm. I start off sketching. So now just having that on my fingertips, like I wouldn't be drawing on paper, like using a Wacom tablet or something like that on my computer. It's just like really interactive and it really lets me like express my ideas and stuff easy. Like if I meet up with someone in person, I could just sketch it out quickly and they see it.
Okay, that's cool. So I guess your workflow is just everything's like digital for you.
Yeah, now everything's digital. Because also I was on the go a lot, so it was hard to keep track of like papers and different stuff like that. But
Yeah, you could, I guess, like with
project.
papers, right? You could just like, you could lose it, like everything, like digitally, you have files, it's backed
Yeah,
up and saved, right? So
for sure.
that's good. So, you know, like when you were just starting out, like learning and stuff, obviously, you know, you have such a big portfolio now, but I guess when you're just starting out, you're still trying to build your portfolio. So, like, did you feel like in the beginning you really had to like prove yourself? Did you kind of have like a chip on your shoulder? Or did you feel like a lot of the people around you like supported you like 100% right from the get-go?
So, to be honest, a lot of people didn't really know I was doing graphic design. It was sort of like
Oh.
me and my close friends that like
Okay.
really knew. Like I would just show them like, yo, what do you think of this? I made this, and they're like, how? And then I would tell them like a little bit about it. But still, even to like what, I'm in grade 11 right now, still into grade 11, not everyone knew that I was doing graphic design until I got like the big publication on like going on like the news about it, and then like a lot of the teachers seen it and all that, but a lot of people didn't really know. But as I got into it, I felt like I had a lot to show, and there were like talents that I can get out there. So I guess that was like where I had to prove myself and get myself out there.
Of course, when you like I can just imagine like at school and stuff with your friends, like when you first started like getting like these big you know album covers and stuff with a lot of well-known artists, like when you went to school, was it like just crazy? Was like everyone going wild, or was it kind of still like you know people didn't really know or some people knew? Like how was it for you?
So it started off early. So when like one of my first placements was the LB Spiffy placement. So at that time it was crazy. Like we're in elementary school, like grade 7, 8, and it's like the big single at that time. Like let's say it was like the 2C slide of that time.
Right. Okay. It was like the number one song. Yeah.
Yeah, and basically everyone was listening to it and all that. And then one of my close friends brought to my attention that I should actually make some art for him.
Okay.
And I ended up doing it. So then when he responded, like all my friends were hyped, and like he screenshot it, sent it to group chat. So like that was like my first like real interaction with like a celebrity to say. And then like that was just crazy. And like it was something that sticked with me with like my close friends. Like when we would go on like video games, they'd be like, yo, Benji Spiffy or something like that. It was always a thing that stuck around with me.
That's sick.
Yeah.
So like speaking of LB Spiffy and that cover you did for him, like
Yeah.
how did you initially like did you just shoot him his manager like a DM? Did you contact him directly? Like how did that opportunity like come about?
I actually didn't even know about managers and A&Rs and all that. Like
Oh
I pretty much
geez,
sent it to
okay.
him on Instagram. So I texted him. I'm like, hey, I made you this graphic. What do you think about it? If you possibly use it and stuff like that. And he replied. So at the point, like nothing was set into stone, but at the point that he replied, it was really exciting. Like I had that moment with my friends and all of that.
Yeah, no, man, I mean, just like even when you know, we contact people for interviews, like, hey, do you want to come on the show? And we're like, yo, like they said yes, like they responded, like we get super hyped too. So I totally understand. So getting into a little bit like of your graphic design that you do, you know, I mean you work mainly obviously with artists and in the music industry. So I want to know like from your perspective, what's unique about creating graphics within the music industry, maybe compared to having to create graphics in, let's say, like a corporate environment or for a corporate firm or business. Is there any difference?
Yes, I really seen the true difference. I found that corporate was a lot like static, and like I found that like less is more. Not to say like less is not that good, but I found there was like a lot of guidelines that you had to follow in the corporate world. And when working with like artists or like influencers, they really had a creative flow, and they wanted like stuff that were innovative and new, and they really just wanted to try out new stuff, where like in the corporate world, a lot of the things are the same, you know,
Yeah, they
where
want
like
to kind of,
white
they have
and
like their
black.
formula. It's like, okay, we're going to stick to it. Yeah.
So
Have
like,
you, sorry, go ahead.
so I stuck with working with artists and different stuff like that. Like I find my balance with both, but I like working with the artists directly because they really let me get my creativity flowing.
No, of course. And like, I can see, like, just from some of the covers and stuff that you've released, like, I can really see that you, like, it's not just like, you know, you take 5 seconds, put together a cover, and it's this. Like, I can imagine there's hours and hours of work that go into it. So, you know, if you can get into a little bit about like your creative process, like, for example, if I was an artist and I approached you for, you know, I wanted to get a cover art design for my album, like, do you have certain like restrictions, like, you know, like, do you work with only artists that are from Toronto, or artists that, you know, they have to have a certain amount of followers, or they have to have a certain budget, or are you pretty flexible with who you work with?
So now it's pretty much the same like routine when I'm working with someone. So mm-hmm. for the creative side, I'll talk about that before I like the approach.
Sure.
It's usually like I listen to like what the client has to say, and like if they have any visions or like what they want to focus on or emphasize. And then after that, I go to like sketching onto my iPad, and then I usually create like a little like mood board and start sketching like possibilities and different stuff. And then I go back to the client and okay. see what they think. And then usually from there, we would either make more sketches or like figure out if that's like the one that we want to use. Like, we could really, after I do the sketches, we could really see where direction we're heading in. And yeah, then we cook from there and then finish it up. But awesome. To your question on like how people approach me, a lot of stuff are going through email now, just because I have a lot of commission coming in
that okay, it's like okay.
hard to handle. So first off, it goes to like the budget. So when I'm working with someone, like, just because there's so much on my plate, then I have like my worth. So like starting with the budget, and then yeah, I'm really open to working with anyone, just as long as like I'm able to do it with like my time schedule and all of that, then I'm pretty much open to work with anyone.
That's good. So anyone who's watched this, any artist you want to design by Benji, hit him up. I'm always curious because like with graphic designers and stuff, well, I guess with your workflow too, it's all digital. Does it really depend on what the client asks in terms of how quickly you can deliver? Like, does it take you know, a while to spit out a design, or is it relatively quick, or does it all depend?
It really depends on the project, but realistically, like, to get like everything, like all the basics down, it usually takes like half a week to a week. Sometimes when like someone has like a more complex vision or something that requires more work, it would take like much longer. Like if it's like 3D work or something along those lines that needs more work, it would take much longer.
Okay. Yeah, no, just thinking about design, like half a week to a week doesn't really seem like that long. That's pretty quick. So I have to ask, because I don't know if any of you guys have seen, you probably have, but you designed Roy Woods' latest, I guess it was an EP, right? So EP cover. So that's pretty cool. So first off, congrats on that. It's a big deal. No problem. So how did that opportunity come about? And have you worked with anyone from like OVO or Roy's camp before?
No, this was my first OVO sound project.
Okay.
And it was pretty special. I want to give you a backstory about like me and Roy. So
sure.
I actually worked with him in 2018. It was indirectly, like I just pitched to one of his managers or something like that. Okay. And I was able to do like this swipe up video for Snow White, the song Snow White.
Oh, good song. And
then, yeah, for sure. And then after that, I basically like knew everyone on his team and was able to connect in that way. But they didn't really end up using it. I don't really know what happened. Oh, and like, I just left it there. Like, I didn't really leave it to like, let me down or anything like that. Mm-hmm. And then later on, I worked on this like more corporate project where he did this event in Brampton.
That basketball showcase
thing?
Yeah. For real? Okay. I actually went, I was there. I visited.
Oh, say words. So you know, like, yeah. The logo that everyone was wearing?
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
the logo that I made.
Oh, no way. So okay. That's cool.
Jersey, it was on the background, like all of that. So it was dope, like seeing everyone on his team in person and be like, yo, I made this. Like, everyone was wearing it. It was a dope experience.
So like, sorry, you were at that event too?
Yeah, I was at that event.
I bet you I walked by you or something. We definitely walked by each other there or something like that.
there was a lot of people there too, like from all around. I'm from Scarborough, so like mm-hmm. even traveling to Brampton was like a journey, but a lot of my friends I seen there
Everyone came together. I'm from Pickering too, so I definitely feel you on that that journey up to Brampton. That was rough. you alluded to it a little bit earlier, but you just got off tour, so you had the opportunity to go on tour with Tory Lanez, which was that's pretty cool. He's one of my favorite artists from Toronto, but he's, especially with Quarantine Radio and everything, he's really blowing up. So how was that whole experience, and how did that come about? Because it's not too often that a graphic designer gets asked to go on a tour.
Yeah, so actually how I got that opportunity to go on tour was when I was working with Tory Lanez artist, or like an artist that was part of one umbrella. His name was Mike's. And he made his first appearance on the song Trap House, and then he was featured on the Chick State 5. So I was working with him on like different creative graphics, like logos on his branding and different stuff like that. So this was all to help lead up to the tour that he was supposed to open up for. So it was pretty easy to, like, it was pretty easy when they presented me to like this opportunity. And when I was working with my friend, his name is MC Ebone. He invited me, like, he's this MC in Toronto that knew a lot of different people. So when I built that connection with him, it was pretty easy to when he introduced me to artists, it was pretty easy to like adjust to touring. And like, we really built that connection and trust earlier on, where like he was even able to come to my parents and like explain like what we're gonna do out there and stuff like that. So like, it was just a dope experience to see like the life out there and like the possibilities that we could, like where this stuff could lead me to.
Yeah, man, I just like, I've never been on a tour. Like, even when you're just describing right there, I'm thinking like, man, like that's pretty cool. Because I think I saw, what was it? I think on Instagram you posted like a little clip of you there was like a picture with you, Pressa, I think it was like Houdini, and then you were there was a slide and you were talking with Tory. So how was interacting with him, like how has that relationship been? Has he kind of passed on any wisdom or knowledge to you, like as someone who's like coming up?
Yeah, so Tory Lanez is actually like my favorite artist, if not one of them.
Okay.
So it was like really natural. Like, we're able to connect on a lot of the things that we like. Like, I was talking to him about like different like albums and like even the history of Chickstape, and like even telling him like a little bit about my story. So like, he was just helping like build my confidence and really like helping me align like where I could head to where I wanted to get to. And was he just giving me like tips and tricks? Like, the advice that I got that day was like really motivating, and just like experiencing that in LA and being around all of these different celebrities was crazy. Like, I met so many people that day. Like, he brought out, like, it was Tory Lanez and friends, but he brought out so many different people. Like,
oh really? Okay. Like who are some of the people? Chris Brown,
T-Pain, Snoop Dogg. Like, I was able to see all these people backstage, and there was like Diddy's son, Quincy. The Netflix series. It was dope seeing him, and then also like Pressa, Houdini, Northside Benji, they're all there backstage, and like, we were the main people from Toronto, so it was dope. Like, I was for sure the youngest in the room, and I got to like connect and see different things for that, like from my perspective, and it was like a dope experience.
That's cool. Now, that's actually a good point that you just made. Like, do you ever, like, when you're, because you know, like, it's just the nature of the business a lot of times, at least for now, you know, when you go into a lot of these rooms, you're most likely going to be the youngest person there. Does that give you extra confidence, or does that intimidate you? Like, how do you feel when you're in these scenarios with a lot of these, you know, bigger artists? Like, are you pretty calm, or how does it work for you?
It's different for, so starting off, it was pretty like nerve-wracking, like interacting with like people that are older than me, and then like, I didn't really have work to show, like they wouldn't really understand what's going on. But now I have work to show, and I'm pretty confident in like getting myself out there and like talking to different people. So now it's just like a normal conversation, and I'm able to connect with different people at different times. Like I could have a meeting with anyone, anywhere, anytime, really.
That's pretty cool. And what I like to think about it too, it's like, because I feel like, especially with celebrities, right, it's like we put them on this pedestal, but like when you actually get into a room and just talk with them, they're just like normal people, you know what I mean? Just like you and me, right? So
yeah,
like that's like,
so one just thing knowing that, like it really changes like how you could interact, like just breaking the ice, like starting off doing that, like if you could just truly be yourself around them and mm-hmm. you both are connecting, it makes the experience much better.
Definitely. And in terms of like connections and stuff, would you say obviously, you know, going on tour and stuff and doing all that is a great way to make connections. But for you right now, let's put quarantine aside, maybe before quarantine started, how are you kind of getting your name out there and networking with people either in Toronto or in the States to kind of get more work and get your name out there?
So basically, I was sharing my work through like DMs with different people. So okay. like different creatives that I seen in the city. Like I was like, yo, I made this. Could you check it out and let me know what you think? Cause it was just like something I was trying out. But then later on, I started to get invited to events and different stuff that I would meet a lot of these different creatives that I like already pitched or like interacted with online, like okay. on Instagram. So once I started getting to those events, I would talk to people and really like explain to them like my vision and like show them different work that I've done. And yeah, it really helped networking because I was just basically having different conversations with people that I met in that room.
Mm-hmm. And I guess like what's so good about Instagram and stuff is like, you know, you can break the ice digitally through DM. And then when you meet someone in person, it's like, oh, okay, well, let's just continue that conversation, you know?
Okay.
Yeah. That's awesome. So speaking of just Toronto and the city in general, I think that's kind of an important topic to talk about kind of going into now, because, you know, the Toronto of 5 to 10 years ago is a lot different than the Toronto now, you know, like, and I want to, like, at least I think that that has a lot to do with like people like Drake, Party, Roy, like all these people have really put a spotlight, not just on artists, but like creatives like yourself, like graphic designers, photographers, like all these people, right? So how has Toronto really influenced you when it comes to design, but also like just you as a person and how you go about your day-to-day life? Like what does Toronto, I guess, mean to you, and how has it influenced you?
So Toronto actually has a big influence on me and like the person that I am today. So Toronto is really multicultural. So I was going to school with many different individuals. So I've really seen many different cultures and like have learned many different languages. I've like listened to many different music, food, and just interacted with so many different parts of the world. And even like going to the Philippines on a service trip and experiencing the thing out there, like it really brought it to home when everything in Toronto is there. And like even going back to talking about the Roy project, I really felt like when we thought of the concept and I brought it to Roy, mm-hmm. I felt like that there was like pressure on me, because like this was like Toronto has this way to like influence it has a tendency to have an impact on different types of people.
Mm, yeah. And
like we impact each other, we inspire each other. So like when I was making that artwork, I was thinking about like this is something that has to catch someone's eye. This is something that like, yo, Drake might see. This is like a debut project. Yeah. A lot of different things that could open doors for me. So just having that and like seeing how Drake really paved the way from Toronto. Like in 2018, I really seen like a lot of music in Toronto drop that year, and like a lot of debuts happen, like Ram Riddles or
Killer Ram, yeah.
albums. Like just starting off their careers at that year, like it's crazy how Drake really paved the path for Toronto and showed the world what talent was here.
Exactly. And now, like, I mean, Ram Riddles is one, but like people like Killy, Anders, you know, like all these artists, it's like, you know, it's just, you know, maybe before they wouldn't be getting the look that they're getting now had the Roys, the Weeknds, the Drakes, how their music not gone so global as it is today. So definitely important. Also too, I want to ask you, because I saw in your Instagram post you posted the other day about the Roy cover, you asked fans to spot the bow tie or your symbol in the art. What's the creativity behind the bow tie? Is there a certain reason you have it, just as like a kind of like your signature on an artwork? Is that what it is?
Oh, it's actually crazy. So that's my logo for my okay. brand. So it pretty much started because the logo that I had previous before this in like 2017, probably, it was just like my initials are Benjamin, like my name is Benjamin Bwamiki, so double B. So it was just like these two B's and like they're like overlapping each other, but it wasn't something because I got the name Certified Benji and it wasn't something that could stick like that double B with the Certified Benji. So I wanted to think of something new. So when it came for the time for me to make a new logo, like I just wanted to connect it to Certified. And like when I thought about Certified, I thought of like something like spiffy and like clean and like, you know, something like like when you're wearing a suit, you know, like this is like business talk. So I just thought of the bow tie. I just thought of the bow tie and really stuck with it from there. Like before it was just something that I would put in at time to time, but now it's really become part of my artwork. It makes it special. It's like I see it as like a certified stamp. You know,
like this is done by you.
So like now having it on every cover art, I think there's more value on it just having that bow tie there. And it's really cool to see like some of my friends, they spotted, they're like, yo, I seen this song on Spotify, and then I seen the bow tie, like, it's crazy, like, you know?
Like, that's pretty cool. You know what it's like? It's like Cole Bennett's, like, little Lenny character that he gets people to spot in his videos, too. It's like that.
It's amazing. Also, like, even with, like, Off-White, I seen how Virgil, like, was branding his shoes. Like, he put this little strip on his shoes to make it, like something that you could identify it's Off-White and something that it could stand out. And that's what I found for like the bow tie. It's something that you see on all my lines of artwork, but it really stands out and fits where it fits into, you know?
100%. I mean, and especially now too, right? It's like the more you use it now, it's just become a part of your brand. So people, you know, they know when they see that it's you. So that's definitely important when it comes to just personal branding. I know I mentioned Cole Bennett right there real quick. Is there anybody in the industry, whether that be like directors, other graphic designers that you really look up to?
For sure, Cole Bennett is a big part of that. And I don't know if there's other creators, like Cole Bennett's a really big part of it, but I get inspiration from a whole bunch of different types of people, like Steve Jobs, or like even artists that like have sure to put like advice out there. And I'm trying to think of who is like that, but even like going back to like Virgil Abloh, like him being very influential in like the fashion industry today. And I think we could say Cole Bennett and Virgil are two people I look up to with even like looking in the way that they brand themselves and push out their artwork. It's really inspirational and motivating.
And they're definitely two, like those are like, I look up to both of those guys as well. And they're definitely two, like, they're just two creative individuals that, I mean, Cole Bennett's pretty young too. So I guess for us, he's, you know, we're easily, you know, able to relate to him. But even Virgil, like he's still just, you know, his stuff he's done with Louis Vuitton, his collabs with Jordan, like those are some timeless stuff that I think, you know, when we have kids or whatever, like 20 years down the line, like we're going to be telling about them, like, oh, you know, like this is who I looked up to when I was your age, you know? So that's crazy. But getting into a little bit about, you know, you're still in school, but you know, there's a lot of people right now who, you know, they're in grade 12, they're graduating, or a lot of people right now who are graduating university. So they're at that time where they're like, okay, I kind of got to figure out what I want to do with my life type of thing. So for someone who is, you know, looking to get into the graphic design field, do you have any advice, any things that they should do to kind of make themselves stand out?
Yeah, I find myself as a graphic designer, but there's a whole lot of other stuff like I'm into. So I guess this is like advice to anyone really, that there's no like real barriers to doing anything. Like everything, every level comes with its own challenges. So you don't really get caught up in those levels and just keep on moving, because there's things that you're going to have to adapt to. And like usually like the first step, like the beginning level is very challenging for many people. So just like doing it and trying it out and seeing like what you like and what you could do to make it special. And also I find that three things that like people should pay attention to are like, number one, your integrity, your relationship, and then your word. Those are three things that I've just seen in the past few years that have really helped me like build my personality and like your character, because these are three things that you can refer to in many different ways why like people would work with you why people would spread the word. So going back to like your integrity, like how you like carry yourself, and then like your reputation, like what people are spreading out, like spreading the word about you, and just like your word. So like your word is pretty much everything that you have. So stay true to that, and make sure to take the right steps that
you can. I think so too. That's really important. Like those are some things that I think, like, you know, every young professional especially should really like take to heart, because it's like, especially integrity, right? It's like you got to be able to, you know, stick to your guts, stick to your values. You know, if you don't agree with something, or you get that inkling like, oh, you know what, like this, something's not right, that you gotta make sure to stick to that. So that's definitely some good advice. I like that. Now, has there been anybody who's given you any advice that has kind of just like stuck with you and just stuck in your head that you kind of go back to when, you know, maybe you need some advice, you're struggling a bit?
Yeah, so there's actually another graphic designer named Max Cohen.
I think I've heard of him. The name rings a bell.
Cover art for like Killy, Little Baby, Gunna, even the recent like Juice WRLD and NBA YoungBoy single.
Oh, really? So, okay.
Earlier on, I first seen his cover with Killy, because around that time was 2018. It was like a big thing in Toronto, and I was able to and like help me learn different things in Photoshop and like how to blend and do different stuff like that. It was actually cool. Like he helped me level up myself and like learn different things, and we even got to collaborate on Little Tekka's "We Love You Tekka" cover art.
Oh, really? Okay, that's cool.
So like those are collabs that I was able to do with him, but he would always give me advice like to maximize like my potential and just like stay down and keep on working and stay consistent and learn different things that you could do in the application, because it's all repetition, but just knowing like key things, like having bright colors on a dark background, like make something pop, like just like different advice like that would help me really carry myself in
for like. That's good. I think you know why I know about him, Benji, because I think I saw an interview. I want to say he did an interview with somebody, and he was talking about how he did. He does like a tour and stage graphics, right? Is that the type of graphics he does? Does he do that?
He's done those as well, but he's mainly known for cover art. But I've seen him do previous stage okay. stuff with, I think, promethazine, maybe.
Promethazine. Okay, I think I'm thinking of the same guy, because he was I didn't know this, but apparently like just for stage graphics and stuff, the guy I was listening to, if it's him, if I'm correct, he was saying how like you need some sort of like software, you need like a, you know, like an $8,000 computer apparently, because the rendering time and the processing for stage graphics is so taxing. Yeah. When you were on tour with Nice, did you do any stage graphics for him, or was it strictly like social media stuff?
We plan to do stage graphics, but just the whole thing with like Tori and Interscope, like I don't even know the details of that. It didn't end up happening. Okay. So for sure, like in my drive, there's sketches of like different stuff for stage graphics. Like I was looking forward to that, but it didn't end up happening. But for sure, there's like room in the future, because like they're independent now. So
yeah.
Or it's a new stuff with One Umbrella.
Mm-hmm. No, 100%. And that, I mean, that just gives them especially just so much room to experiment, work with different people. They're not constrained, right? So that's cool. But yeah, because I was like, oh, well, if you were to do stage graphics, I can imagine you probably have got like some $10,000 computer or something. So I was like, oh my God. just getting towards the end here, you know, obviously right now with COVID, everything is kind of, you know, uncertain, but just putting that to the side, do you have any goals on your vision board, or any, you know, anything on your list that you'd like to be accomplished for this year?
Yeah, for sure. Like coming into 2020, like I had different things that I wanted to do, and like some of them I'm not even able to do to this day because of like, we can't do anything with COVID happening. But the main thing, I just want to give back to the people that have been there for me, or like even people that want to get into something similar to like what I'm doing. So just give back to the people and like inspire more and follow and help people follow what they love and are happy to do.
Definitely. And I feel like you do a little bit of that through like your YouTube channel, because I was watching like you do a lot of tutorials and stuff on, I mean, like even some of the stuff, like I know a little bit, but like even some of the stuff I was like, oh, I didn't know you could do that. So are you still like going to be posting like videos and stuff like that, or like for content for people to learn? Like, is that going to be something you're going to continue to do?
Yeah, I pretty much left those up on my YouTube for like people to see like the whole experience of everything. But with my YouTube, I plan to get back into it, but I just have a different vision. Like I want to cover maybe like the behind the scenes and like give people advice and different things that like I see on like a day-to-day basis that I could probably help out someone new getting into this. And like
Okay.
even like interacting with many artists, like I think people would like to see the behind the scenes, like how these people are in the studio and like just different stuff like that that you can't really find like anywhere else. Because on YouTube, there's a bunch of tutorials that you could follow. So I think the tutorial bases are like already there, but just me doing like what I do and in a special way through YouTube. I hope to get into that soon.
Definitely. And I mean, like you definitely have the connections to make that happen. So
Yeah.
hey, I'll keep an eye out. I'll stay tuned for that.
It's crazy because when I started in 20, I forgot what I started, but I didn't really have a lot of these connections and I didn't know a lot of YouTubers. So like the people I was looking up to in YouTube, I had the connection to today. So it's pretty crazy how I can tap back into it.
Yeah, I mean that, yeah, that's crazy to think about.
Yeah.
So for speaking of that though, for people who, you know, they want to work with you, they want to get a design from you, they want to check out more of your work, they want to follow you, like where's the best place to find you at?
The best place is Instagram and like along with like Twitter. I've been pretty active on Twitter recently. So
Okay.
those are the two best places to like to talk with me per se. But for business, I do everything through email. So if you're looking for work to get done, my email is business@certifiedbenji.com. So you can get me there and then we could work on anything really and I can help that bring that idea to life.
Awesome. And we'll make sure guys to leave all that in the description box below. So when you guys see this video, you know, any of the socials you want to follow them, hit them up for any designs or graphics or anything else, you'll be able to do that. So we actually you know, we put out to the Instagram verse and Twitter verse some asked your fans if they had any questions to ask you. So we got some replies back. So just wanted to you know, ask some questions to you right now that some fans had submitted. So the first one is by Francis King underscore 10, and they asked, what's your favorite thing about graphic design?
My favorite thing about graphic design. I think my favorite thing is how I express like I guess the music or the different things that someone's trying to portray. Like someone might tell me like just having it in words is one thing, but expressing it through like a graphic is another thing. So like even connecting with design and all that, like having stuff that like literally mean it or like have a deeper meaning, like I really think that's cool. And I like seeing it. Like some stuff have like multiple meanings to it and people could take it different ways. So I find that's really cool.
And it's cool too, I guess, when you hear people's perspective on some type of art that you get, and you're like, oh, I didn't know that they would see it this way, but I guess it could be taken that way too.
Yeah.
So the second question is by SS Swab09, and she asks, where do you see yourself in 10 years?
Where do I see myself in 10 years? For sure, I'll still be in Photoshop doing whatever I'm doing, but 10 years, how old would I be? I'd be 26. So,
That's a long time. That's a long time ahead.
I think in my vision board, I'd have like a lot of stuff accomplished, and I probably started off a lot of the things that I'm thinking about now.
Okay.
Like, would have been in action already and probably like done on a very big scale. Like I really have a big vision or like goal that I want to reach. So I think by then for sure like it would have been solidified and like a lot of stuff would be like put into place. Like I'll do stuff for my family, stuff for my community by then. Like I don't know, 10 years,
It's a long time, but hey, you know what? I believe you can do anything, right? So I mean, you're off
yeah.
to a good start already, so I have no doubt that you're gonna get everything accomplished you want. Okay, so we got two more. So the next one is by 090CE. They asked, what's the most important advice you have to upcoming entrepreneurs?
I think it goes back to the advice that I said to before, and just like doing it, really. Like, the first step might be very challenging, and a lot of people like me might overthink that step more than they need to, because, like, you know, it's like their first time. It's something
scary
that they're
presenting.
Yeah, it is. So I think just like believing in yourself and finding a way to like stand out and be special and be true to yourself.
I know, I agree. So last one is motivation for the week asks, do you prioritize bigger artists over emerging artists in terms of getting cover art done, or do you treat kind of everybody the same?
So I do get work deposited. So how I work, I get 50% like upfront. Mm-hmm. So I do keep everyone that has deposited work on the same level. But let's say there's like a bigger artist that gave me deposited work, like over at other artists that's like upcoming. Yeah. I would probably work on the other one first, but I would communicate to them like what's going on, and like they know I have many different projects, so it usually works out well.
So I guess their communication is the key part, to make sure that you're communicating between both parties. Awesome. Okay. So that about wraps it up. Benji, thanks for coming on the show, man. I really appreciate it. I had a great conversation with you. Like I said before, I'll make sure to leave all of Benji's social links, Instagram, Twitter, his website, and his email in the description box below, as well as ours. So if you guys want to keep up to date on Real Collective, we'll make sure to leave our socials in the description box below. And yeah, thanks for tuning in, guys, and we'll talk to you soon.